Okay, so welcome back to our IONS Metro DC community group meeting on a very significant day when hundreds of thousands of young people and others stepped forth to say, let's get to the heart of the matter, as some of you just said. And what does it mean to get to the heart of the matter? And why, after so many shootings, including of little children in elementary school, we have still not been able to get to the heart of the matter. So I was thinking today that it would be really helpful to come back to the topic of heart, but not so much in terms of the intellectual discussions that we've had already about the role of heart-based consciousness in health, about the importance of heart-mind alignment for optimal functioning, even about the intelligence of heart. Come and join us. We've had these conversations and we've had the opportunity to really develop an appreciation of the fact that the heart is a very intelligent system. It's a system of human intelligence and it's pivotal to our experience of health. But today, I was thinking that it would help if we could. Do you want to turn, pull your chair forward and circle with us? Great, thank you. Perfect. Today I was thinking that we could focus a little bit more about what it means to have the actual experience of being heart-centered. What is the actual experience of being heart-centered? So that's moving away from the intellectual conversation of the importance of heart in human health and intelligence, and really getting to what is the nature of a heart-centered experience. And so the way that I want to think about it and talk about it today is to pause and reflect together on the nature of the reverent heart. And because it's such a significant day, we have to ask ourselves, it has been 19 years since the Columbine shooting, and there have been shootings, ongoing shootings practically every year. And yet, nothing has shifted. So clearly, we have lost reverence for human life. We have no reverence for human life, not even for the lives of children. So what is the experience of a reverent heart? That is a phrase we don't even hear anymore. In fact, the only context in which you hear the word reverent used is to address clergy. Isn't that amazing? That we have so moved away from the concept of, or the experience of, a reverent heart, that this word only functions as a way to address people in a particular role. So before I continue, I wanted to ask us to take a few moments and actually connect with our hearts as we've done in the past. Put your right hands on your heart area. Close your eyes and begin to center your breath into your heart area. Apply gentle pressure so you can really connect. And as you breathe in, expand the heart area and feel it grow more spacious. And as you breathe out, exhale tension and thought and drop into the quiet. Breathing in spaciousness, breathing out noisy thoughts and tension. And with each next breath, dropping deeper and deeper into our inner quiet. And as you continue this meditation quietly for a few moments, reflect on what a reverent heart means for you. You feel ready. Let's come back to this circle and share what sense emerged for you of a reverent heart. Jessica, come join us here.
Bubbled up for me was the loss of any sense of other.
Wow, the loss of any sense of other. Thank you.
What was coming to me was a feeling and seeing your creation.
A feeling and seeing of the beauty of creation.
And all its manifestations.
Thank you.
It's funny, I just got to the point of the making space, so I think I was just feeling the space. It may be somewhat connected in other realms as well, but I think that that was, there's something with the reverent heart that has space.
A reverent heart has space.
Mm-hmm.
Wow. Okay. Anything else? Came up.
Yes. The last time that we met talked about the heart and the source of energy in the heart. Mm-hmm. And David Bohm, the quantum physicist, who had this concept of the creation of all matter, how it formed. And it really formed from mind, but if you really get it down to physical terms, the implicate order is the essential part of things. It's really the mind of things, the intent of things. And our being, or the physical thing, is the what he called the explicate order of things, which is the manifestation in matter. And he has a whole algebraic expression for how all of this works, and still being developed today, but he's been there for 25 years, but he's been extended. So I thought that if I am being created from these orders, I could think of no way better of having that. I would need to have a great energy source. Mm-hmm. And of course, it would be logical to have the greatest energy source, if that is the greatest energy, to be the heart. So if I'm in tune with the heart, then I'm really getting in real touch with everything, with who I am. And so that was the thought that I had about it. Mm-hmm.
Wow. So the heart as the seat of universal energy that connects us to the implicate order of all things, mm-hmm. of creation, of reality.
So the more I'm in tune with that, the more I'm fulfilling that purpose.
Any other thoughts anybody may want to put forth?
I think the image which came to my mind was just a prison.
Huh, a prison.
Prison.
Like a million prisons, like where we're all in our own prisons, where it's almost like, I think this is something which I wondered to myself too, where when you hear about these incidents, like, you know, you imagine yourself being there or someone you know being there and you feel the pain. Or at least I'm just talking from my perspective. But then there is something holding you back from actually going and doing something, however small it is. But then you also see some people for whom it's very natural to just go and do things. And so I just felt like, oh, there's a person holding us back, and it's one of those mental things where you know, yeah, I can just go 10 minutes and sit in a march and do things, but again, I'm not able to bring myself to go and do things. Go there, so I just put it as a prison.
Mm-hmm.
So it's not for lack of feeling. You feel like I should do something, but then the inertia of motion is not there. It's just inertia of rest. You're just stuck in the prison.
It's interesting. I wonder if the reverent heart is what moves us out of the prison.
Mm.
I wonder. But it's maybe a thought to reflect on as we continue. Is there anything else that anybody wants to add? If not, I will share with you an experience of reverent heart, which is Edgar Mitchell's experience as he was watching the Earth from outer space. As he actually described it to Dr. Eben Alexander in their meeting. So he describes that the spacecraft was rotating every couple of minutes to avoid any area overheating in the intense sunlight. I could see 10 times as many stars as you can ever see from Earth, so the view was spectacular. With the rotation, I would see the Earth, Moon, and Sun pass by the window every few minutes. The immensity and serenity of the universe struck me in an entirely new way. Out there, suspended between the great blue jewel of Earth and the dusky moon, we were leaving behind. The setting was perfect. I suddenly sensed the profound consciousness of the universe, how it is completely interconnected and aware and absolutely undescribable awareness. My life was changed forever. So this really captures the experience of a reverent heart, the epiphany of this reverence of being present to life from a place where you don't try to explain things away. You're just struck. You just see. Of course, the experience of reverence is not just associated with epiphanies. It is also very much possibly a part of our daily lives. And that's really what I wanted to talk about. But before that, one more unusual example of the experience of reverence, which is right up there with being in outer space looking at the Earth. And that's the experience of near-death survivors, who describe, of course, again and again, and I'm going to quote Dr. Evan Alexander here, but that is consistently what survivors of near-death experiences describe, but he puts it as that undescribably comforting force of knowing, trust, and pure unconditional love, that basic intelligence and creativity, the core essence of the universe. That undescribably comforting force of knowing, trust, and pure unconditional love. That's what people describe as experiencing as they leave their bodies and find themselves in the presence of what they refer to as the light. And oftentimes in life review. In the presence of this undescribable force of knowing, trust, and unconditional love, the heart finds rest. And you remember that our sequence of talks began in the first lecture with the question, what is ailing us? Why is it that we cannot find rest? We are not finding rest. It is in these kind of experiences of reverence that the heart, in fact, finds rest. How can this be part of our daily lives? I want to share with you today my personal experience with that. For Baha'is, the month of March is the last month of the calendar, Baha'i calendar year, and it's called the month of loftiness. So the 19 days from March 2nd to March 20th are the month of loftiness, and that's the month in which we fast from sunrise to sunset, no eating, no drinking. And it's an amazing experience. It truly is an experience in altered consciousness. What happens is we experience reality on so many levels and so differently than ordinary consciousness that it's really something worth trying to understand and describe. On one level, of course, you know that you're fasting along with fellow human beings all over the globe. Millions of people that you don't know, and some that you do know, are fasting with you all over the globe, and that is a powerful feeling of connection. Mm-hmm. On another level, of course, you're feeling the hunger pains that really, really connect you to the fact that every 2 minutes, I believe, is the statistic. A human being, most commonly a child, dies of hunger. And so just imagining that becomes so much more vivid when you fast. But more and more with each next day of fasting, what also happens is that you start to experience a separation between the experience of your body, which is hungry and weakened and tired and definitely slowed down, and this awareness, which has absolutely nothing to do with the experience of the body. And it's just aware of everything. In fact, extremely aware. As the brain chatter begins to quiet, which is what happens with fasting, and the brain, we know Dr. Evan Alexander speaks about it as a filter of primordial, unlimited consciousness, a filter that actually allows only as much into our awareness as we can process. And so as that chattering filter begins to quiet, we begin to experience this heightened awareness of many levels of reality beyond the physical realm, beyond what's immediately happening. So I was moved to bring this candle to the center today, and I wanted to ask you to look at the flickering light for a moment. And just watch that flicker. This is how I found myself seeing people during the fast. I was actually seeing the flicker of their spirits, quite separate from the personalities and what people might have been saying or doing at any particular moment. Just flickers of pure consciousness. And somehow I had glimpses of how each of these spirits, each of these souls, are experiencing life one eternal moment at a time. One eternal now at a time. Without necessarily even understanding what is really happening, what the reality is that is being experienced. So, fasting, of course, is an ancient practice. From ancient times, people have recognized the power of fasting and the health benefits of fasting, but also, even more importantly, the spiritual benefits of fasting, the power of fasting to help the heart surrender. And that is what seems to be the prerequisite for the experience of reverence. The heart surrenders. It surrenders its pride. It surrenders its reactivity. It surrenders the insistent self. And it opens up to that same kind of eternal presence that Edgar Mitchell got a sense of from outer space watching planet Earth. We actually catch glimpses of that very same reality right here and now, on the street, in the store, in our most ordinary settings. It's an experience of surrender, of ordinary ego-based functioning, and catching a glimpse of the eternal, of the consciousness the implicate unfolding in the explicate, in the language of David Bohm, which you brought up. Linear time becomes a lot less real. The sense of eternal now is quite profound. And it's interesting because you get a sense of how life co-arises interdependently, how each movement in me engenders movements in you, and each movement in you engenders movements in me, and our spirits are co-creating together. And that's a reality that we don't see with our ordinary eyes. So fasting opens up this deep perception, this depth perception. And I'd like to quote here Confucius. This actually was a book that I wanted to highly recommend, The Supreme Remedy, Applying the Natural Healing Arts to the Fast. An outstanding book by an outstanding healer by the name of Deborah Walters. Deborah Walters will be here in the Virginia area giving a workshop next Saturday from 2 to 5 in the Virginia Baha'i Center, which is in Reston, Sterling.
She's also going to be in DC that evening giving another workshop.
Here. In the deep,
in the Foggy Bottom area.
Wonderful. Thank you for announcing that.
Sure.
Maybe if people are interested, you can
sure.
give us a bit more details at the end.
Of course.
Her work is extraordinary because she has really looked at physical aspects of fasting, food, nutrition, how to relate, how to purify the body and your relationship to food and nutrition during the fast. What that means emotionally, what that means mentally in terms of our insistent self, in terms of our mindsets, in terms of our ordinary thinking and opening depth dimensions of thinking and seeing, and ultimately what that means spiritually. So the book is really an extraordinary inquiry into the power of fasting to really transform consciousness. And also a tremendous resource of some very detailed knowledge. But she quotes here Confucius, and I'd like to read that quote. The goal of fasting is inner unity. And when the faculties are empty, then the whole being listens. When the faculties are empty, then the whole being listens. There is then a direct grasp of what is right there before you. That can never be heard with the ear or understood with the mind. Fasting of the heart empties the faculties, frees you from limitation and from preoccupation. Fasting of the heart begets unity and freedom.
Fasting of the heart.
Fasting of the heart begets unity and freedom. Extraordinary. When the faculties are empty, then the whole being listens. Then there is a direct grasp of what is right in front of us, a direct grasp, which can never be heard with the ear or understood with the mind. Fasting of the heart empties the faculties, frees you from limitations and from preoccupations. It begets unity and freedom. So, the ultimate effect is the discovery that we do not have to be so attached to our desires, cravings, opinions, impulses, inclinations, positions, that when the heart fasts from all of that, there is a profound and deeply reverent seeing that opens up. So, through the listening, reverent heart, we can feel divine breezes flowing freely. Divine breezes flow from every direction, all the time. We're just not aware. Most of the time, we're just not aware. We're so caught up in linear thinking, from this to that, to the next, that we do not perceive the forces, the energies, the realities. So, again, the flickering flame of every soul is something very different than protective personality. In linear time, in linear thinking, we experience the clash of protective personalities. And the world that protective personalities create, which is a world of no reverence, a world of plenty of violence. In this personal world, there's plenty of absolute thinking. Always, never. There's plenty of predicting or trying to predict. It's going to happen again. Oh no, I just know it. I'm going to fail. A lot of assuming. She hates me. A lot of taking things personally. A lot of blaming. A lot of labeling. A lot of taking offense. I have the right to be upset.
A lot of projecting.
Yes, a lot of projecting, thank you. The listening and seeing heart, oneness with all life and with the unknowable essence of all life. And that is the nature of reverence. As John said, no other, the experience of no other. The more we experience moments of reverence, the more the ego, the insistent self, becomes increasingly subordinated to the flickers of the more enlightened soul. That same ego that desperately spends its life building one wall after another, because it finds this world to be hostile and dangerous and rationalizes the protective stance and uses linear thinking for those rationalizations, as that same ego becomes restrained, the walls become more permeable and become gently released, and we begin to build a house without walls. I want to share with you a book that I recently enjoyed very profoundly. a fellow American, Bradford Miller, wrote this book, The Soul of the Maine House, for those seeking a spiritual home in America. And it's a book that weaves beautifully his very concrete, very lived experience of building a house in Maine with his metaphor of the lives we live as the inner houses we build, and how these inner houses that we build are connected to history, to the generations that have gone before us. And in the case of every American, that involves a deeply disowned reality of genocide on which the house, the inner house of every American is built, and which has to be integrated, brought into full awareness in the very same spirit in which Native Americans understood that the houses they built or the teepees that they built had to be in complete harmony with their environment, with nature. So too, in this book, he explores the journey of, he calls it in fact a radical religious reflection for those seeking a spiritual home in America. So what does it mean to build a house without walls? In the here and now of our very concrete, very pressing realities, as Dr. Alexander puts it, the consensus reality of the physical realm serves as a convenient stage for the unfolding of the eternal now. Gladly.
Thank you.
I was wondering, do you think you could sit across so you're not outside of my view? Thank you. I feel like I'm not making eye contact. Thank you. Today we have the privilege of the opportunity to make eye contact with everybody, which is delightful. Thank you. Yes, he says that the consensus reality of the physical realm serves as a convenient stage for the unfolding of the eternal now. So to unpack that, the physical realm, which we consider so firm, so solid, so absolutely real, is in fact a consensus reality which we are constantly co-creating out of consciousness. And it is simply the stage, the setting, in which one eternal now at a time we grasp the heart of things, or we miss the heart of things, one eternal now at a time. To understand better why we speak about physical reality as consensual, consensus reality that arises, that we co-create from our consciousness, we have to remind ourselves of the finding of quantum physics, of empty space, that much of what we experience as solid physical matter is in fact vast empty spaces. And here again, I'm going to use a metaphor, actually a comparison that I draw from Dr. Alexander's third book, Living in a Mindful Universe, which I highly recommend to all of you, where he reminds us that when we think about the atom, the nucleus of the atom relative to, so the nucleus of the atom and the electrons, so the mass, the sum total of the mass that is in the atom, relative to the empty space inside the atom, can be compared to the size of a gnat in the Notre Dame Cathedral. So once again, the size of the mass inside an atom relative to the size of so-called empty space is the size of a gnat relative to the Notre Dame Cathedral. So this empty space, which is not mass, is nothing but vibrating strings of energy in higher dimensional space, vibrating strings of energy. And as we are constantly patterning that energy through our consciousness, we are creating and co-creating reality. And this reality then becomes the stage, the consensus stage, in which one eternal now at a time, the heart has a chance, an opportunity to see core reality or to miss it. In each such moment of seeing, because reality exists in the eternal now, in the energetic realm, the way we see effectively affects, impacts patterns that we consider past occurrences. So the way we see right now, in fact, can repattern past events. It's really hard to grasp with linear mind. And yet it's interesting how profoundly the heart rests as we sit with these experiences and descriptions. So linear time is an illusion. Near-death survivors speak of deep time, where all of our perceptions exist within the one mind of the unknowable core. That is deep time, where all of our perceptions exist simultaneously in this one mind. There are plenty of evidences of this kind of phenomenon, but one that is particularly striking was first published in 2011, and it was a scientific paper that documented conscious cognitive awareness in people seconds before the computer randomly selects stimuli to present. Conscious cognitive awareness in people and a reaction to what they're aware of seconds before the computer randomly selects what to present them with. Of course, that gave impetus to a whole string of experiments that Dean Radin, one of the main scientists in residence at the Institute of Noetic Sciences, began with their team ever since 2012. And these are all experiments that show these kind of precognitions, document these kind of precognitions, and they also document how observers actively, even when they're at a great distance from phenomena, mm-hmm. in fact influence events. So again and again, we have lots of evidences which mainstream science is keeping fairly marginalized that show that consciousness is primary. And maybe you're getting increasingly the sense that a reverent heart opens us to pure consciousness, to pure conscious awareness. Ever since, John, you brought up the example a few meetings ago of this experience that you had when you decided to walk in the street and look at each person as your child. People have remembered this, and many people have come back to this example that you brought up. This moment where you made that decision for yourself to look that way as a wonderful example of what it means to find a state of a reverent heart in the ordinary daily life. In these kind of conditions, of which this is a great example, the other side constantly contacts us. And we describe that as small convergences that somehow make our moment's effort a little easier. We feel maybe somehow assisted just a little bit. Maybe even we describe small confirmations. Really, the more we plant ourselves firmly into the space of a reverent heart, the more we actually do feel the assistance from the so-called other side. Or we can think about it as the assistance of levels of consciousness that truly coexist and interact if we are aware of them. So, Princeton physicist John Wheeler is quoted concluding, as a result of much research, that no phenomenon is real until it is actually observed. And he's captures it even more succinctly. He says, to be is to be perceived. To be is to be seen. So, cultivating a reverent heart is what these children and young people mm-hmm. we're trying to appeal to today. Cultivating a reverent heart is what all wisdom traditions from the beginning of human civilization have really been about. That's what fasting is about. That's what meditation is about. That's what prayer is about. In the middle of the 20th century, there was a very extraordinary spiritual teacher in Bulgaria who was well known to Yogananda, who was at that time traveling throughout the Western world and teaching about a reverent heart, no doubt. And when asked whether he would like to cross over into the Balkans and come into Bulgaria to teach, he said, no, there is another far wiser than me who's teaching there. He's known in the West by the name of Ben Seduno. He was Christian, and he really subjected Christianity, and particularly Eastern Orthodox Christianity, to a profound rethinking. And so he's considered by the official church a heretic, of course, and was very persecuted, as was his whole following. And he taught right between the two wars and during the Second World War very actively, and many of you may have heard that at that time Bulgaria was actually the only country in Europe that never submitted its Jews to Hitler. It's an ancient land. New archaeological data is starting to point to the fact that the Black Sea may be in fact the place where Noyes, what was the name of it? Where the deluge took place, and Noah's Ark was built and launched. The oldest gold treasure known anywhere in the world was actually found in that area by the Black Sea in the city of Varna. Ancient Thracian gold. At a time when there was actually no civilization anywhere in Western Europe, the Thracians in that part of the world were masters of refined gold jewelry. So this is a very old land, very ancient land with deep, deep, deep spiritual roots, which is being historically mangled by centuries and centuries of violence and oppression. But when this particular spiritual teacher appeared in the mid 20th century and began to teach again, he spoke once again, as the old Thracians did, of the fact that everything outer is an expression of the inner, and that every organ in the human body has a dual function, a physical function and a spiritual function. And that's the only way we can understand health and become healthy. And he gave some amazing examples. I'd like to just list a few because they really connect to our topic today. In Bulgarian, mm-hmm. his name is Peter, so that would be P-E-T-A-R. Danov, and that would be D-A-N-O-V. But in the West, he's known as Beinsa, B-E-I-N-S-A, Duno, D-U-N-O. I think it's a sacred name he adopted, and that's the name by which his work is translated in the West. So he says, everything God created exists in miniature in a human being. Each of us is a string of God's instrument, and on it plays the divine concourse. The human body is the result of divine energy. The soul, this unique emanation from divine energy, builds the physical body, which is ever-changing, and as we know, changes completely within 7 years. It's completely renewed within 7 years. Every organ in the human body, as well as the whole body, has a dual function, outer and inner. The heart purifies not just blood, but also our feelings. the stomach digests not just food, but also our lower passions. The brain regulates not just the nervous system of the body, but also the place and the role of every thought. And he concludes, the human brain can only serve the purpose of this physical world. With our hearts, we know ultimate reality. And then he says, because he was also known as a remarkable healer, and he's, there's books and books published on his approach to physical healing of the body. So he says, truth is necessary to restore the balance of the human body. Truth keeps digestion healthy. Truth has to lay at the core of the human heart in order for human beings to be healthy. So I'd like to close with a few quotes from Eben Alexander's Mindful Universe, Living in a Mindful Universe, where he speaks about how his relationship to prayer changed after his experience in coma. Until then, he was fairly agnostic and, of course, hardcore materialist scientist. I think we forgot to turn up the heat here. Are people feeling a little cold?
I was wondering if we could use this one and...
Could you please? Yeah. Thank you so much. It was warmer when we first came, but I think it's getting a little chilly. Sorry.
I've been eyeing this device for a couple hours.
Oh, no. Okay, so here's what he says about the power of prayer that he discovered in his life. A hardcore agnostic scientist after his return from coma. As we proceed from the stark implications of pure scientific materialism into more expanded versions of understanding the role of consciousness in manifesting reality, we glimpse that being more aware of our inner world through meditation and centering prayer offers vast potential to the individual soul to take charge of their lives through harnessing the power of love and compassion in the spiritual realm. So, as we move from scientific materialism to understanding the primary role of consciousness, we come to appreciate the power of meditation and centering prayer, and the vast potential they offer to every individual to take charge of their lives through harnessing the power of love and compassion of the spiritual realm. And two more.
It seems like it's a little cold. Yeah.
Cold air?
Yeah, I think
that's an air conditioner. Well, isn't that dandy?
Thank you for trying, yeah. Margaret. Yeah. I'm sorry, we really should have done that when we first arrived, but we forgot.
I can't get it to set higher. It says it's 50, so that's not a plus. We'll make it stop. And now we'll feel better. It's perception.
Oh, it's already getting warmer.
No more candles doing it.
Maybe what we need to do is turn it on from outside, and that's what will allow this to respond as well. Okay, another quote that I find also very compelling. He talks about his father, actually, who was a deeply religious man and a very prominent neurosurgeon. And he describes his deeply reflective practice of science including the daily management of neurosurgical patients and the teaching of neurosurgical residents who would become leaders in the field, melded seamlessly with his deeply spiritual beliefs. He believed that his part in healing any patient was minuscule, and he trusted that the power of prayer and an omnipotent and omniscient God were the main means of healing. So you may want to consider, when you choose your treating physicians, finding out if they are ever in the practice of praying for the patients. So, finally, he refers here to a process of return to heart, finding one's deepest center, awakening to the profound depths of our being. Perhaps that's what these young people are trying to tell to the millions of paralyzed adults who seem to be incapable to do what it takes to ensure safe childhood for all of our children. Perhaps they're asking us to return to heart, to an epistemology of heart, to knowing through our hearts, so that we can see the simple solutions in the complex brain noise that we have created and that we call our social environment. So on March 21st, which was the day of the spring equinox, Baha'is began the new calendar year, as it also used to be in many of the ancient calendars, which generally recognized the beginning of the year with springtime. And so I'd like to close with a quote from Abdu'l-Bahá regarding this day of the spring equinox and the new year. The sacred day when the sun illumines equally is called the equinox, and the equinox is the symbol of the manifestation of God. The sun of truth rises on the horizon of divine mercy and sends forth its rays. This day is consecrated to commemorate it. To me, this means that the sun of truth shines equally on all of us, just as the sun does in the day of the spring equinox. So every one of us has the opportunity, regardless of our past, regardless of our personalities, regardless of our traumas, regardless of our ideologies, regardless of the political positions we have staked, or ideological positions we have staked, we have the very same opportunity to awaken the reverent heart within at any point in the eternal now. Thank you.